you're all about to receive the greatest gift that any human being could possibly ever receive for the first time. It is a gift which has a value beyond even our wildest imagining. There is literally not even a dollar amount which can be attributed to the gift you're about to receive today. Because this is a gift which prepares us not only for this world, but we put it so very clearly in that gospel. This is a gift which prepares us even for eternal life. It's a gift which is meant to bring us peace, not only in this world, but in the life to come. And what a great gift. It's this great gift, though, and its nature, though, that I really need to reflect with you upon, because it is something which goes beyond even human conception as to what it means. It's a gift, though, that you're able to receive, though, as a promise, as well as a pledge. It is something that was anticipated when your parents, who are seated next to you now, brought you here, even at a time you may not remember, for your baptism, as an infant. To be able to enter then through the waters of baptism through this cause, you became sons and daughters of God. So much so that the day that the world today might be reveling in the reality of, oh, all the royals, perhaps you saw this wedding happen across the pond. Do you realize those, even the titles they receive in England are just titles? You are adopted sons and daughters of God, who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And as such, you are all dressed so beautifully as you are today, dressed appropriately, because you do not realize that makes you a prince and a princess. And truth and reality, you are royalty, because you're God's sons and daughters. For the promise and the pledge of this, which is why I ended up doing the sprinkling rite. When I walked through the church to sprinkle everyone with water, it was to remind us of the baptism we received and you received through these waters, which then brings us to today, because baptism has made us a part of God's family. Today you're about to receive the greatest gift, because you're about to receive Jesus himself. So much so today that when you go home later today, or perhaps friends of yours throughout the week might ask you, what it is that you did on Saturday, but then indeed again tomorrow on Sunday, you can say, I went to church and I ate God. This is our faith. Because you see, we're here in this beautiful church, and there are many images here that are meant to remind us about God's presence in the world. And I suspect somebody who maybe has never even heard about Jesus Christ before might be able to come to this church and point and be able to say that above the altar here, this crucifix, as it were, of Jesus on the cross, that must be a person who's someone important. But if you look at this image, and if I were to point and say, look, that is an image of Jesus, I think you would point out and say, well, okay, but it's just an image. If I were to be able to somehow go along and climb the ladder and as I tap my fingers against it, realize if I'm doing that, I'm tapping a piece of wood. Right? It's a statue. It's something that's meant to make us think about Jesus. But you would all be very correct in pointing out, if I were to go up there and tap it, I'm actually just tapping a piece of wood. But this sort of depiction of Jesus is very different than the Jesus you're about to literally consume. Because when I, as a priest, hold on to the Holy Eucharist, which looks like bread, tastes like bread, and everything about it says it's bread, you and I know in faith that it's not just bread that I'm holding in my hands, that it's actually Jesus Christ himself. I'm holding on to God. When I have the privilege to be able to give you your first Holy Communion and then place it in him on your tongue, God himself, you are coming to personal contact with God. It's different than just coming in contact physically with this cross, which is just a symbol. make the biggest thing of God. When we connect with the consecrated host of the Eucharist, we are actually touching the living God. Although under the appearance of bread and wine. This is our faith. And it's not just in my thought or the opinion of perhaps of a few pious people throughout the world. This is a teaching that Jesus himself talks to all of us. And it is a difficult teaching. In fact, we heard about it today in that gospel. When Jesus says to the great crowds and multitudes of thousands of people who were following him, he tells them a great blessing. And he says to them, you must eat my flesh. Now, when the crowds heard Jesus say that, their reaction, a little bit of what you've heard in the gospel, well, they heard him pretty clearly. I mean, that sounds kind of gross. Think about it. If a person were to come up and you say, you must eat my flesh, you're like, that's kind of nasty. But when they heard Jesus say that, do you know what they did? What the reaction was? You pick it up. The people who heard Jesus say that they must eat his flesh got grossed out, and they started to walk away. They thought, this man, he's crazy. He just said we have to eat his flesh. That's disgusting. And they walk away. But you know what's very telling, though, is Jesus' reaction and response. The one who picked it up as well. Jesus, as he sees the crowds of people who have been following him starting to leave, and maybe leave him alone, he does not go back to them and say, well, wait a minute, time out, hold up. Let me clarify this. I mean this symbolically. I mean it kind of like a statue. If you come close to me, it's going to remind you. That's not what Jesus said at all. No, he said this instead. He said,
amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of God and drink his blood, you will have no life within you. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. He made it more strict, lest there be any doubt it was the intention of Jesus that we should eat his flesh. But for what purpose? It's so that we can move from this life into eternity. He said, whoever eats my flesh will never hunger and will live forever. See the edge? Excitement, this is it. You're about to literally, it's a true statement today, come to church and for the first time, you will eat God on the appearance of bread and wine because he wants to share with you and to me, the greatest gift that he can give us, which is his very self. He wants you to make a huge difference in the world. But he doesn't want to have you do it just by saying, here, there's a lot of really difficult things I want you to do. Go figure it out on your own. But no, Jesus says, I'm going to do it with you. So much so that he feeds us in our stomach. Now, I don't know about you guys. You guys like food? I love food. Mm-hmm. Oh, I love food. And the idea of Jesus trying to then speak to us through our stomach is something that, in that sense, we're human beings. It makes sense a little bit. It's God. You are God's adopted sons and daughters. The closer we come to the Eucharist, the more capable we will be at doing whatever it is that God has in store for us. We'll make an extraordinary difference in the world. And to each of you that today, who are receiving the communion for the first time, truly, you have our great gratitude for your beautiful faith today, supported by your parents, because you are a reminder to all of us of something that maybe we become a little bit more accustomed to. You know, we have chances to receive communion so many times, and sometimes we forget just how profound and important it is. So please know of our support and our gratitude and our sense of excitement, and I pray an excitement that you so clearly have radiating from your faith. That this is something that will kind of light up the fire in our own hearts a little bit more. Because those of us who received Jesus in the Eucharist before also have that same promise and pledge of life to come. And immortality to come. Where we realize there is no, in Christ's sense of eternity in heaven, nothing that can separate us from his love. And I think in a world where China now seems in such a period of upheaval, and such a sense of pain in families which parents were aware of, which are being separated from each other. That's time to realize what's true. I said this is about the greatest gift that you've ever received, and you ever can possibly receive. It's Jesus himself. And there's no amount of money or any sort of other price that we can possibly put on the gift you're about to receive. But I still want to think about this though a little bit more with you. I promise, I'm going to wrap it up. Who wouldn't want $1 million? If I were to give you $1 million in a big briefcase, would you think I ought to take it? Would you be willing to take it? $1 million. Yes. Oh, oh yeah. I don't know, I'd go run out, buy a sports car, or whatever. $1 million. If you were to have $1 million, if I were to tell you that there is a bank just down the street, anytime you go to the bank, they're going to give you another $1 million, just no matter what. How many times would you go to that bank? Would you be like, well, you know what, I have $1 million and I'm pretty happy with this. All you need to do to get another $1 million is just to show up again. Once a year, twice a year, maybe once. Or would you show up basically every day? Every day, the honest one. Yes, holy cow, what do I live with? It's $1 million. All you have to do is show up and get $1 million. I share this image because I'd like you to think about how amazing it would be to get $1 million every day. To realize the gift of the Eucharist, the greatest gift you can possibly ever receive in a lifetime, is a gift that we are welcome to receive even every day in Jesus Christ. Not just every day, but certainly the church would invite us to do so every weekend and every holy day. Why? Because God wants to give us gifts. The church wants to give us gifts. Not only that would affect us in this lifetime, but in the life to come. And the great reminder that you are to all of us, a little bit older, perhaps a little bit more accustomed to the mysteries that we're receiving here, so much so that we became a little bit more comfortable with it. You serve as a reminder to us of the gift that is in the Eucharist today. And for that, we're grateful. And I guess there may be a little bit of a challenge in the sense of a wonder. How often might we avail ourselves to the gift that is in Christ? I pray it's not only today, not only this weekend, but tomorrow, coming. But every weekend, from now until we all meet again as an eternal family at that banquet in heaven, which awaits us. Congratulations today. Sure, of course, you're about to receive the greatest gift and the new community.